Hello, everybody, and welcome to our Livestream Lecture of the month. This month's topic is Saddle Fit for the Ever-Changing Horse. So thank you guys for joining us. If you are tuning in on Facebook or on YouTube, please let us know where you're tuning in from. And if you have any questions on the topic, save them for the end of the live stream, or you can post them in the comment box and we will answer as many as we can in this episode. And if not, we will carry them over to our next hashtag Ask Jochen Q&A episode. So thank you guys for joining. And we will just quickly move on here and proceed with our intro sequence and then welcome Jochen into the session today. Welcome, Jochen.
How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Very good. I have a little problem right now. I have to check my yes. I have the wrong internet going. I apologize. I need to reset the router. So let me know if I'm still. I'm looking good now. Am I still?
Yep, I can hear you fine. I can hear you perfectly fine. Yep. I think the intro was a little bit slow, but all good. I think we're still connected, so.
Yeah, I think it was just because I'm sitting close to my neighbor's house and my computer always picks up there.
Oh, gotcha.
And very slow, and then I catch it in the last minute. So anyway, here we are. And today we had a very interesting lecture because I think many of us who started riding, we bought a saddle and thought, okay, this is it. You know, this is my saddle now for my horse. And then the horse changed. And this is where all the problem starts. And we don't know why it changed. So welcome, everybody. My name is Jochen Schleese. I grew up in Buenos Aires and rode horses since we came back to Germany in the late 60s. The reason why I'm telling you all this is because I grew up with horses, love horses, and I have been with horses pretty much all my life. And I like this picture what we chose today because we can see horses who start very young, and then like us, when we get older, the muscles disappears very fast. Here you see a gray horse with a big shoulder blade, and all the area is where the saddle used to sit, muscles are all disappeared. But even when we ride the horse, you know, we train the horse before we take a horse over large fences. I mean, I can't believe this is my horse. I got him when he was 4.5 years old, and I trained him all the way up to 4-star 3-day eventing. I can't believe how the horse changed, just alone from improper or proper dressage. You know, how, if you ride your horse properly through his back, and how his top line changes then. So as a rider, you know, you see the neck, you see the back muscles, you see the butt, you see the chest is getting wider when they groom the horse. But what you don't see, and never think about it, how does it affect the actual saddle area where the saddle sits? So, and that is something we want to talk a little bit about and describe it. I think what really drove this home for me when I was working together with, oops, wrong slide, with veterinarian who also trainers who work all over Europe. Karen Liebrand is a veterinarian and a dressage instructor, and she calls her company 4D Dimension Dressage, and she explains it wonderful how we can ride a horse correctly or incorrectly. And what that means is if we get the horse to lift their back and bring up the shoulders, or if the horse actually goes inward. Now, when I talk about riding. I'm not just want to mention this lecture to dressage. Even if we have, let's say a working horse, a Western horse, and you say, well, I don't do training. I just work with my horse. You know, we all change. And when we buy shoes, that's the best way you can think of. And eventually your foot doesn't grow so much anymore, but your foot still changes even as an adult. So at what time does human feet stop growing? In the late 20s or late teens? And the question is, at what time does a horse's back change? At what time does the horse stops their growth plates? So the skeleton, and especially where the saddle sits on, that stops when the horse is 6 years, some breeds at 7.5. So when we start riding, is it racing? Is it Western? Sometimes at horses at 19 months, you know, that early as 1.5. So that is an enormous amount of stress to their growth plate, skeleton, and of course, psychological. But even if we think back and you talk to dressage riders or jumpers, and they say, oh, when do you start your horse? Oh, I start mine at 3, 3.5. Even then, he is relatively young. In Europe, we call horses between 3 to 6 remonte. And remonte, if I translate that to the human words, I call them teenagers. And teenagers grow and change. Back to the shoe story. Okay, so a teenager goes through several growth spurts. And when it comes to saddle fitting, I hear very often people say, hey, you know what? I'm going to get him a really nice saddle when he's finished riding, finished developing. So some horses develop as late as 7.5. Does that mean you would like to ride a horse for 4.5 years in ill-fitting equipment? Kind of like you say to your son, you get really good fitting shoes when you're 20 years old. But in the meantime, you're going to wear shoes which are too tight and not fitting you. So you can imagine if you would do that to a child, you deform their feet. As a matter of fact, they used to do this in the way back in the 1400s when they wanted to have women really small feet. So where they have these deformed feet. Most of our riders who love the horse, you know, who see, I really want to do the best. We care for the horse and we want to do the best, not just in shoeing, but also in the way we care for him, feed him, and so on and so forth. Absolutely, absolutely crucial is to understand the circle of influence to the horse's back. I already started to say how I train the horse. Do I, as a trainer, I might have a trainer as a rider, or be my own trainer. I don't work with a trainer. So you pick and choose how you would like to bring your young horse up, and you want to teach him various lessons, all right? On various, okay, you want to teach him now bon vert, travers, lateral work, or left lead, canter lead, or flying lead change, or jump, etc. Okay? So with or without trainer, you become the trainer, and there is certain method. You can train him hollow, or you can train him round. And that is where many, many things change. So let's jump ahead and think, what if you buy a horse, he's 9 years old? A nine-year-old horse, what has already fully developed in terms of the growth plates, still changing. This is why the chapter today is for the ever-changing back. So the question is, why does the horse always change? And I say, always change where? In the angle of the shoulder. Where else? In the circumference of the girth. Where else? In the shape of the shoulder. This is in front of the saddle. And behind the shoulder. So you see lines here. Okay. That measures the cross-section of three muscles. The rhomboideus, the trapezius, and the spinalis. Okay. They are part of the top line group, they help to to bring the scapular upwards back, stabilize the spine, and of course, form the neck. Then down here, the bottom two lines, that measures the cross section of the latissimus and the longissimus. Both muscles, most of the time when the horse is ridden, elongates, okay? It's not contracting as much as the trapezius would do or the splenalis. So the latissimus contracts, elongates. Same with the latissimus. When the horse's leg goes forward, the latissimus stretches, and when the leg comes back, it contracts. The only time when the latissimus contracts at the same time, and this gets wider, if the horse is rearing or jumping. So that's a big, big importance for me as a saddle manufacturer or for me as a saddle fitter. I need to know how to fit a jumping saddle versus a dressage saddle, because a dressage horse never jumps. It used to, but not anymore. Here we have the cross section of the shoulder blade. The bottom line here is where the cartilage start. The cartilage is between these two lines. And below the line is where the angle of the shoulder is. We measure it with a leather covered with a tracer or a shoulder tracer. And we measure it with the gauge. We call that the Sprenger gauge, also angle gauge. This angle device is made by the company in Germany. It's called Hermann Sprenger. So a short form for this tool is called the Sprenger. And it measures the angle of the shoulder and the angle of the withers. So when you measure a young horse, the biggest difference is between 3 and 8 and after 15. There where you see a lot of angle changes. The next thing you see is how the shoulder becomes steeper and wider into this a little bit more. And then this here, okay, this area, you see the red triangle drawn in here. That's a cross section of the splenalis, trapezius, and rhomboideus. On a horse foot, it's ridden properly. That gets wider. And these get narrow. Then you think, how can the horse get narrow when it gets trained properly? Well, I'll get to this in a minute too. And just like humans, we can measure on the heart girth the condition of the horse. So these changes, what I just showed you, also changes, of course, on the nutrition. So if you are a very good, very tough athlete, and for me, horses who carry humans are athletes. So, and if the nutrition is not correct, the muscle atrophy rather than build. So nutrition plays a huge factor how you keep the shape, make the shape, or lose the shape of the horse's body, and not just getting a fat tummy. So the muscles need a lot of proper nutrition to sustain the training. Veterinarians, the most veterinarians I work with, they always said to me, I got into this with the very clear distinction that I follow the saying, do no harm to the horse. I also know some veterinarians who are absolutely fed up with just burning the nerves or injection after injection. Says, this is what I went to university for and studied all this just to inject steroids in the horse. So most veterinarians know very well what the horse needs from shoeing to nutrition, and they want to keep your horse, well, fit. So I would always suggest follow veterinarians who have a little bit more all around view. There's more and more veterinarians who understand that there is not just the Western medicine, also the Eastern medicine, which is chiropractic, acupuncture, etc. And they can make a huge difference on the well-being, but in this respect, the change of the horse's body. If I just numb in the pain, the horse will not lame, but other muscles will come in to support the joint when it's not working properly, and all of a sudden the horse does change the three-dimensional shape. Body workers, yeah, I'm going to skip tack in a minute. Body workers, anywhere from osteopath to physiotherapist to massage therapist, etc., play a huge role into the shape of the horse's back. Right. So imagine how often you have stepped in an uneven step, and then all of a sudden you feel like, oh, I'm out of alignment, or oh, my muscle seizes up, and we can stop with the workout because it really hurts. The horse can't speak. It shows you a little bit lack of resistance going forward, and you're going to make him go forward. So, of course, he wants to protect himself. He's going to start to develop uneven, or he's going to develop in the same way like I explained with the veterinarian. If a veterinarian just blocks the pain, other muscles will work more, and it deforms and changes the three-dimensional shape. If the horse has a body worker would make sure the muscle is nice and supple and works properly, all the alignments is right, the horse has a chance to develop properly. And it goes on and on. Same with the farrier. Okay? So there's an old saying, no hoof, no horse, makes the same line. And there's a lot of different thoughts of shoeing, barefoot. There's all kinds of research and advancements on that. That plays a massive role. Funny enough, the farrier can always see how the horse walks because that's how he wears his hoof. And it's amazing how the saddle fit and the shoeing goes hand in hand and mirror each other. I'm going to come back to that also later. And then, of course, the age and condition. As I mentioned already, in the age from 3 to 8, the horse changes a lot. And after 15, the horse's three-dimensional shape changes a lot. And condition, I mean, with also where you keep him, if he's constantly in the box or if you see in an open field where he can always move. And then we have the rider. Okay? The rider has the choice to ride really, really heavy or very, very light. What do I mean with that? If the rider rides in the gender-appropriate saddle, the rider will be able to feather his or her weight and rides half his or her weight. If you ride in a non-gender-appropriate saddle, nature takes over, which means you're automatically trying to protect yourself from hurting or seizing up or chafing, etc. So what you do is you're becoming very rigid in your pelvis, and you come twice the weight in the horse's back. Obviously, that changes the three-dimensional shape. Now, I did skip tack, which is anything from girth to your martingales, your additional training reins or aids, as well as, of course, the saddle. Some saddles are made so the horse does go hollow. Okay, so I'll give you an example. Some of them are the Tennessee Walker, or they want to have the horses with the false elevation, high, high head, high, high shoulder, high, high steps. And you see the saddle is extremely long. The rider is placed in the rear of the saddle, all the way in the back of the saddle, because that way you can get the horse to lift up in the front. So that's a tack or a saddle what is specific made for that type of riding. And in dressage, we have different styles now too. In the old days, we called it the show trot. Today, we call it the dressage, unfortunately, even though it has nothing to do with dressage. If you look at the actual rule books, we don't see an engagement. So here is the tack, what makes the saddle go, the horse go this way, hollow, with a very, very high front leg. And in dressage, you see here, the hind leg is not parallel with the front leg. It's a different topic. And Xenophon was a association in Germany formed in 2004 with top Olympic riders, veterinarians, and judges who tried to fight against the roll cure and hyper extension. So unfortunately, this changes the horse's back, not necessarily to the positive, but it changes the three-dimensional shape. So with all these different specialists around the horse's back, we want to make sure that the horse can move free. So here you see down here, and you can see how the shoulder moves back and forth. You see how the muscle contracts and elongates when the horse is moved. So obviously this goes way faster in the trot or in the canter. This is slow motion. But when a muscle contracts and elongates, that's how you work out, and that's how these muscles get through. And when that happens, then the reinforced tree with the metal will not allow the muscle to contract properly. So what muscle am I talking about? Okay, so the muscles, what makes the shoulder goes backwards, and where the muscle where the rib cage hangs on is the serratus and the trapezius. And that is right here. You can see the trapezius from the side connects to this spine of the shoulder blade and then goes back up here. Look, it's like a triangle, trapezius. Okay, so that muscle brings the scapula upwards, backwards. Then when I have a weight on the horse's back, okay, so I'm talking about any weight. Doesn't matter if you're racing, a jockey, or if you're a Western or English rider, artificial weight, these muscles will become bigger. And when these come bigger, the serratus and the pectoralis become bigger, they go further out. So the distance from the top of the shoulder blade from left to right becomes wider. Now in the saddle fitting world, we call that the tree width. The tree angle is the angle of the shoulder blade. So younger the horse, so shallower or so flatter the angle. So longer you have ridden him, so older he is, so steeper the angle will become. Okay? So when we talk about tree angle and tree width is how wide it's on top. You can see, so older the horse gets, the more he gets ridden, okay? The more he carries riders, the wider that gets. Then is the tree angle. That's the angle of the shoulder blade. That becomes steeper and steeper. Now here's something very funny. And that is what is in nature, we call that muscle disappears 4 times faster than it appears. Most of the trainers do not want to have vacations because when they go on vacation, they say, oh my God, I'm going to go on vacation now for 2-3 weeks. There goes all my training. So let's say you have ridden the horse and all of a sudden you put him away for 2-3 months over the winter, all these muscles go back where the muscle needs to. So it goes back to the original shape. Now you can imagine, you say, oh, I have 2 completely different horses, one in the spring and summer and one in the fall and winter. So if you do not have a saddle, what can be adjusted in the tree width and in the tree angle, then you have a lot of problems. The horse will not be able to collect properly. Collecting means the bear comes up, haunches come in beneath to the sternum, so they become very light in front and lift up the shoulder. Doesn't matter if you do a sliding stop or you do a canter pirouette or you want to jump, okay? The shoulder cannot slide through if the metal plate is not giving the space for the shoulder what is wide. So you can say now, what if I buy a saddle what is very, very wide and very steep in the angle, but very wide? What if he changes? You don't want to have the metal poking in when the angle gets wider. So remember, the metal plate here okay, needs to be changed in the width and in the angle. So here now we're looking at a cross section behind the shoulder. The trapezius, that was when I showed you the measuring tool, the first white line, okay? Under the trapezius is the splenalis, the rhomboideus, and that muscle, if the horse is properly trained and the saddle fits properly, that muscle, those three muscles get wider, okay? So that you see on stallions, they're right away, they have that bigger, wider wither cap, the wither area where the saddle sits over, okay? The longissimus dorsi gets stronger, but longer, not thicker, okay? So remember, the longissimus is 8 inches down, starts at 4 inches, and then another 4 inches, so 8 inches down from the withers and 6 inches down from the back of the saddle, okay? So when the horse goes like horse A, stomach is contracted and the long muscle is elongated. If the horse goes like B, in other words, you want to ride him like the Tennessee Walker or the modern dressage horses, whether I ride the short trot, then of course the top line goes hollow. You know, the long muscle here contracts and this elongates. Okay, so depends on what style or discipline you believe or ride, the horse will change in the muscular structure and the skeletal structure. This is what happens. If you choose to go like B, skeleton structures will be, inevitable will be hissing spine and huge, huge problem on the animal. So this is not something I make up. This is from various books you can read, universities who've written papers on that. These two veterinarians who talks on that. So no matter what I do with my horse, the body of the horses change. Here's the cross section of the front, okay? The neck and head is gone. You're looking at the elbow, the sternum of the horse and the elbow. When these muscles, the serratus and the pectoralis gets wider, it lifts the rib cage. Unridden horse, now look where the rib cage is now. Boom, the whole rib cage came up. So when a horse is properly ridden and trained, the muscle will get wider. So the distance from left to right gets wider. And the whole bony rib cage comes up. So the bone here looks like the horse grew. Think about yourself. If you put your heels, your butt, your shoulder, your back of your head against the wall, okay, and really stand straight, make a mark on the wall, and then slouch. Then you will see how you shrink. So imagine on animals like horses who don't have a collarbone, right? There is no collarbone that connects the scapula to the rib cage like on humans, okay? Imagine how much flexibility this is. So now let's say you train the horse and now you stop riding him. After 3 months, all they go back the way they used to be before you even start riding. So that's one of the reasons why most trainers do not want to ride. So they say, train. I can't get these words out of my mouth correctly. If you have a trainer who doesn't want to train or ride, find another trainer. What I meant to say is, if you have a trainer who doesn't want to go on vacation, that's the reason why, because it's so hard to keep the horse fit. And all of you horse owners know, you know exactly what I mean, because what's happening is that the horses sometimes have injuries, sometimes can't be ridden, and then they have to stand for 2-3 weeks or sometimes month, and then you start again. The good news is, once they had the muscle width and strength, it comes fast back. And that's why I chose this topic as the ever-changing horse's back, because in life things happen. Sometimes I can't ride every day. So the change in the angle of the shoulder, in the width of the shoulder, and the wither height is a constant. Okay? So again, I want a saddle like this one here, where it rests on the longissimus dorsi, on top of the ribcage. We have clearance on the withers, and where the trapezius has room and motion to contract, and where the scapula in upwards, backwards motion, so when the leg goes forward, that upper arm pushes the shoulder blade upwards, backwards. So it needs to slide, there needs to be an opening. Why do I want the saddle to sit on this strong fat muscle? Because it's the thickest muscle. It's the strongest muscle. And it sits on top of the rib cage. These muscles, trapezius, rhomboides, and spinalis, they're very, very, very thin. And lots of spinal nerves are in this area. And no horse likes to be pinched. You see this a lot, where the gullet blade and the tree is too narrow, left and right, and the angle is too wide. So imagine this comes down. This is all mush on the side. The support you find down here. Here you think that looks pretty good, but still it has contact when it comes down there, but it will have no room for the shoulder blade to slide through, or for the trapezius, spinalis, and rhomboides to contract. So if I have a saddle, I can change myself in the tree width, angle, and in the flocking, then I can have at any given time a nice fitting saddle through the ever-changing horse. My recommendation, when you buy a saddle, always ask the salesperson, can I do it myself, or can you, as a saddle fitter, change the tree width independent from the tree angle? And can you adjust that saddle through the asymmetry of the horse in the gullet plate? If they say no, then I would find another fitter. If you say, well, I just buy another saddle if the horse straightens out again or changes shape, that's of course your prerogative. We need to understand, when I say the saddle tree has to be adjusted in the tree width and at the angle, also has to be adjusted in the even or unevenness of the horse. 7 out of 10 horses have a bigger left shoulder, the mane goes to the right. And if you put a symmetric tree on this horse, the scapula will be damaged, your saddle will be crooked, and the horse will have spinal issue. Now, because the horse can change all the time, you may be able to make this horse through training straight, if it's just muscles, okay? But if the horse has already compensated in the bone structure, okay, you can't change it with lunging, with training, with riding. Unfortunately, you do not know this until the horse is 7.5 years old, and you cannot x-ray it when he's 7.5 years old, if it's structural or just muscles. So only 1 out of 10 horses look like this, absolutely straight. Some horses are bigger on the left, some bigger on the right. The majority of the horses are bigger on the left. Hence, in the training scholar, number 5 is straightness. I need to make my horse straight. So when you look how horses graze, okay, how they get their foot down, they're put always one leg forward, just like you, a horse is left-handed or right-handed. So if I have a equipment what fits the bigger shoulder, I know I'm not going to cripple the horse on the left shoulder, which is going to cause you stifle problems on the back right and hock problems. And most likely, that's a common trend, you will see a splint on the front left. These are the common pattern, not just in North America. This is everywhere, on all the continents I have traveled. So if we're working with animals who are carrying unnatural weight, which is humans, okay, muscles will change. Horses do not have a collarbone like humans, and we as humans do not walk as horses. So if you can visualize where your heel would be, your knee would be, how your back would be, okay, you know yourself how you change in your posture. The ultimate goal the ultimate goal is when I ride, I want to have a plumb line. Why? Because then I ride with half my weight and I'm a very gentle but effective rider. Number two, I want my sternum over the horse's sternum aligned. I don't care if you're a jockey or dressage rider, you always will find the sweet spot. That's the balance point. Now, if my horses become stronger, the shoulder gets wider, the rib cage lifts, that throws my balance off. If my horse gets sick or uneven, that throws my balance off. So the ever-changing horse, I cannot emphasize enough, start off with get yourself, I sound like a broken record here, but get yourself the proper gender appropriate saddle. That's the number one, because you will not change as much as the horse. Yes, of course you will change. You can also say, I'm getting older, I'm going to change in my physique. You could say, I'm going to lose 35 pounds or gain 35 pounds. Of course you could. But that's very highly unlikely that the majority of the riders do that. You could also say, well, I'm a girl, but I want to be a boy now, or vice versa. You could also say that, but your skeleton wouldn't change. So even if you do operations or you age, your skeleton, what determines the gender appropriate saddle, will be with you all the time. So you start off with the right gender appropriate saddle, what fits your skeleton. Then next step, you're going to ask the instructor, or sorry, the salesman who sells you the saddle, is the saddle adjustable, not just in the angle. Most saddle trees are adjustable now, are adjusted in the angle, but the majority are not adjusted in the angle independent from the tree width. And mostly, is my saddle adjusted so it doesn't kick the saddle to the right or to the left? We are always the first to blame. We always say, oh, it's me, I'm crooked. Of course we're crooked. But the majority of the horses are crooked, not the majority of the riders, to the fact that the saddle shifts that much to the right. Oh, I'm gonna train him right. No, you can't train him right. If he's going to put the saddle, you see the dustpan who goes to the side, the rear of the saddle digs so much in the T18, T17. So there is a massive problem on the horse's spine, which causes a problem on the lumbar. And of course, the left shoulder gets damaged. Doesn't matter if the horse goes right or falls left, you got to have a saddle what can be adjusted to this. There is a big, big, talk about, oh, my saddle fits all horses. Yeah, those are the saddle most likely when they hang on the spinal nerve, so the channel is very narrow, and they sit on the shoulder blade, which of course we all know who have listened to me before or who do acupunctures, know people who do acupunctures, never want to have a saddle on the shoulder because that plays huge role in the respiratory health of the horse because that's the lung meridian point of the horse. I talked to you earlier. You want to get the contact on the longissimus. Look how big that muscle is. Look how thick that is. Okay. And that elongates and contracts. Elongates and contracts. So the distance from left to right stays the same in movement. This, however, the splenalis, the trapezius, the rhomboides. Look how narrow the trapezius and the rhomboides is. Look how narrow that is. And that little sucker here, the splenalis, super sensitive, right? You want always make sure when these three muscles, and here's the latissimus, see? When these three muscles, okay? When these three muscles start to develop, you don't want to have it pinching. Otherwise, how is the shoulder ever going to come through? Will the horse change? All the time. Will he get straighter? Not if he's deformed in the upper arm, which is settling until he is 6.5 years. So you can imagine you ride horses who are very young and you have not had fitted horses from the get-go. I always say when people ask me, when should I get a saddle? When he's mature or when I start riding? Every time the saddle should fit. But if you only want to give your horse one comfort, do it in the beginning. when the horse expects from you or wants from you to understand, hey, what do you want, right? So what do you want from me? And you want him to give you your trust. So especially when they're young, the saddle needs to fit. Saddle needs to always fit. If not, the horse will deform. This hunter bump is a very, very common knowledge, right? It could come from falling, from slipping, but we can make every horse instantly get a hunter bump. I only have to hit one of those reflex points on the horse's back, because these reflex points here, the spinal nerves, or the bucking reflex points, or here on the wither area, okay, instantly I can make the horse go hop. Okay, I just have to put a little pressure on those reflex points, no more than the same pressure it takes to squish a lemon out, and the horse will, well, deform to the stage like this. So this lecture is, for me, very important that people understand. There is a saying, an old book written from Udo Berger in 1913, the rider forms the horse. And most professional riders, especially when they went to the German training academies, they know that book. It's one of their books they have to read. Okay? I always say the saddle forms the horse and the style of training forms the horse. And look at that poor horse. Look at the atrophy this horse has. So if the saddle really fits, one horse fits all, sits on the spine, okay, we have enough veterinarian, we have enough body workers who can prove to you with tools, with explanation, you know, you cannot put pressure on the spine. And you can operate on it, same like you can believe in hyperextension or roll cure. Okay, you might get a high number, but your horse will not go to the next season. Okay, so there is actually a proper way that the horse does not have to be deformed or get into this, what we call holding frame. You want horses to be happy and not give up on life, because they do speak. They do speak and they do say to us, I don't like it. I always say the horses speak, look at their mouth, the eyes, the ears. You know, it is what it is. And the horse changes all the time. And that's why it's so important when you have a saddle fit out, they need to measure the wither cap. They need to measure. This area is so crucial. Okay? And hopefully if you do that, the horse will last a long, long time and will have a healthy, healthy life and enjoys your company as if you like it. So, Mary Claire, we open now for question and answers.
Beautiful. Thank you so much for that, Jochen. We don't actually have any questions right now, so I'll just give people a couple minutes, see if they have any questions on the topic. I have gotten a few questions, but they were just more personal things that I've answered personally. So anyone who's watching on YouTube or Facebook, feel free to let us know if you have any questions on this particular topic. If not, you can save them for our next live stream, which will be March 10th. We're actually taking a bit of a break because Jochen will be away, but we'll be back March 10th for a live stream Q&A. So it'll be perfect timing for, I'm sure we'll have a bunch of questions to catch up on. So I'm just going to revise. I'm pretty sure we don't have anything else right now. Okay, so thank you everybody for tuning in, and we'll be sure to save all those questions for our next session. And we'll also be doing another giveaway of a digital copy of Jochen's book during that session, so you won't want to miss it. Again, it'll be March 10th at 5 p.m. Eastern time, okay? Thank you, Jochen, so much for another great lecture. As always, like, there's so many topics for us to discuss, and I think this is such an incredible, valuable time that we have with you. So thank you for your time, and thank you everyone for tuning in.
Thank you. Talk soon. Bye-bye.
Bye.